many of you know, peripheral arterial disease is a significant problem in our cardiovascular community, and patients often suffer chronic debilitating illness as a consequence of this. It affects their ability to perform meaningful exercise, to have a good quality of life, and obviously is associated with the worst cardiovascular outcomes. Now, in these patients, an attractive option instead of open arterial bypass surgery is to perform endovascular procedures using stents. And paclitaxel, which is a drug that is coated on drug-eluting stents, has been the standard of care for many years now. Hello, my name is Dr. Saraschandra Vallabhajosila, and I'm a cardiology fellow at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. I'm here to talk to you about our article looking at the use of paclitaxel stents for lower extremity peripheral arterial disease. So what is the background for this perspective piece that we wrote? Well, in 2018, December, there was a meta-analysis of 28 studies that was published in the Journal of the American Heart Association that showed a slightly higher risk of death in patients receiving paclitaxel-coated devices, be it balloons or stents, as compared to the standard of care, which was different in each study. Now, this created a furore in the interventional cardiology, the interventional radiology, and the vascular surgery community. Many of these communities met either individually or together trying to troubleshoot and understand why this was. The Food and Drug Administration issued a note of caution and said this needs further evaluation. The Society of Cardiovascular Angiography and Intervention, which is one of the leading societies in interventional cardiology, issued a guidance supporting the FDA and said clinicians need to take these factors into consideration when counseling patients. Soon after that, in March of that year, two large trials that were recruiting patients for these devices were stopped in light of the safety concerns. During my third year of general cardiology, I had the opportunity to participate in a regulatory science curriculum as a part of my master's degree. And so this was obviously a natural choice of controversy to understand from a regulatory standpoint. So the FDA convened a multidisciplinary representative panel of patients and of stakeholders and had a detailed conversation about this. Now, the main issues that came up, which we highlight in our paper, are one, study design. Now, as many of you know, a meta-analysis is not the best study design to make any judgment on correlation or causation, especially if it's not a patient-level meta-analysis. That means it was a cumulative or a summative meta-analysis. More importantly, as you will note in our write-up, there was a significant attrition to follow-up over the course of time. In hospital outcomes or short-term outcomes, there was excellent follow-up, but at 2 and 5 years, a large part of the population was lost to follow-up, which is a significant concern. Now, you also might ask, what is a biological plausibility? And that's a good question. We don't know the right answer. It would seem unlikely that a device delivered with a drug in the lower extremities can cause anything to affect the central systems, be it the heart, be it the lungs, be it the brain, that might result in death. It's even more layered if you consider the fact that our colleagues in oncology have been using much, much higher doses for cancer chemotherapy without any tangible side effects. Therefore, what is the mechanism? And these were the issues that were debated at the FDA panel meeting, and I don't think there was a concrete conclusion on this. But what is safe to say is that disease states such as peripheral arterial disease that are being studied from an interventional standpoint need better data. There is excellent data, long-term follow-up, and other such positive attributes to studies done on the heart arteries or coronary artery disease that we think should expand into the peripheral space. We think that we should have larger registries, larger for longer follow-up, closer follow-up of these patients. So for the practicing clinician then, what is the take-home message? Well, paclitaxel-coated devices are still the standard of care. We believe that the use of these devices are fraught with some risks and many benefits. And so when we make that judgment, we have to take our patients' considerations, preferences into account, have a shared decision-making process, and highlight to them the concerns that were raised and evaluated and opined on by the FDA, so that our patients, who are smart and capable themselves, are able to make an informed decision on this matter. Thank you for the opportunity to present our work in the Mayo Clinic proceedings, and thank you for reading it. Hope you have a good rest of your day. Thank you.
We hope you found this presentation from the content of our website valuable. Our journal's mission is to promote the best interests of patients by advancing the knowledge and professionalism of the physician community. If you are interested in more information about us, our homepage is www.mayoclinicproceedings.org. There you'll find access to information for our social media content, such as additional videos on our YouTube channel or journal updates on Facebook. You can also follow us on Twitter. More information about healthcare at Mayo Clinic is available at www.mayoclinic.org. This video content is copyrighted by Mayo Foundation for Medical Education and Research.